Hi, everybody. So, I've got an interesting case that I came across, and just got a few learning points from it. So it's quite an interesting one. It's something we see maybe once or twice a year. Normally, it's managed quite well. In this case, it's not that it was handled badly, but just that it could have been handled better. And it's just an interesting case that gives us a chance to talk about a few things that can occur with head injuries, which are quite complex, especially in terms of treatment. But in terms of initial management, it's not that difficult the majority of the time. We just have to look out for danger signs and know when to pass on to more relevant department. So in this case, we had a 23-year-old male patient who was stabbed over the forehead. So, well, in hindsight, it was quite a deep stab. But at the time when he had come in, he was noted to have normal GCS, normal vitals. The only thing that was noted was that he had a type of watery epistaxis. So it sort of was controlled with a bit of gauze and plugging. And it was noted that he had a fracture of the frontal sinus. Now, the thing is, the notes, this patient didn't tell us how bad the fracture was. He just said that he had a fracture. And they noted some bubbling at the injury. So it was noted, and it was kind of left at that. So this is, is there any, two or three worrying things over here? So watery epistaxis, number one, should start pointing you towards CSF. You should start thinking about a CSF leak, and well, fracture of the frontal sinus we've discussed just now, and bubbling often means air. So the question is, where is the air coming from? So the patient was sent for a skull X-ray and was noted to have a fracture of the forehead on the notes, and that's all that it stated. Now, well, that's technically correct. We must remember that we have to be quite thorough with our notes. When I say thorough, at least let's say specific rather than thorough. So in this case, it was a fracture of the anterior table of the frontal sinus. So even that would have made life a lot easier. But in any case, the wound was sutured. The wound was washed, which was a good thing. But the patient had his wound sutured. There was no notes on what would be done about this forehead fracture. And the patient was discharged on antibiotics and sent home. So it was noted that he was a bit intoxicated, although not to the point where his glascoma scale was affected and things like that. And that was basically it. Now, the thing is, he came back 16 hours later. So this was on the next shift. And now, by now, the GCS had dropped to 14, and he had this fluctuating, bubbling, swelling over the suture area. So, there were actually bubbles, according to the notes, coming through the suture line, and it was quite fluctuant as well. So this was starting to raise a bit of concern, especially because he was no longer intoxicated and things like that. So luckily, the CT was done at that point, and it showed a fracture, not just of the anterior table, or the anterior wall of the frontal sinus, but also a fracture of the posterior wall of the frontal sinus, which is always worrying because directly behind the posterior wall is your frontal lobe. And I mean, that's what controls personality, that's what controls higher thought functions and things like that. And this patient had a pneumocephalus on top of it, which is air within the cranial cavity, which we'll have a look at now. And he had a fracture of the left orbit, including the maxillary sinus. So he had all of these sinuses that were fractured. He had this fracture of the anterior table, posterior table. He had air in the cranial cavity. So he had quite a bit that was going on just from the stab. And what becomes obvious after that, it wasn't just a stab, but there was also blunt force trauma. So, even though he had been stabbed, maybe the assailant's wrist of first also hit into the face and caused fractures, or maybe he was hit separately or whatever it may have been. So even though I never saw pictures of the patient, but you could imagine that there would have been some swelling, and it would definitely have contributed to the epistaxis and things like that. So even though he wasn't managed poorly, because or when I say not managed poorly, what I mean is that he was seen, assessed to have a good GCS. And based just on that, yeah, it would have been fine just to discharge him. If you had a small linear fracture of the frontal sinus and you washed it out, didn't look very deep, and call him back for review, it wouldn't have been a problem at all. But it comes quite obvious from this that the patient actually had quite a deep injury, that the bone had to have been pushed back. So it was a depressed fracture, because that's the only way that the posterior table can be affected as well, you know, and or the posterior wall can be affected as well. There's much space between the two. So, you know, and the fact that the patient had pneumocephalus means that there was air now that was seeping from those sinuses in. So there was quite a bit that was going on. And the left orbit fracture was also just a bit worrying. So this is something that we will see from time to time, which is pneumocephalus, which is air in the cranial cavity, which you can see here. Now, this isn't this particular patient's CT. Unfortunately, I couldn't track it down in order to get it for this. So this is just an example of pneumocephalus in this case. And if it's small and it's asymptomatic, it can be treated, you know, relatively conservatively. But once it becomes symptomatic, as is the case with our patient, then it needs to be treated by the neurosurgeons as well. So basically, in his case, and from what I could see in the notes, he was transferred to Albert Luthuli Hospital. The neurosurgeons took over the case along with the maxillofacials. They repaired the fractures and they allowed the brain to decompress as well. So it didn't seem as though the pneumocephalus, sorry, the pneumocephalus was quite severe, although it was causing quite an increase in his intracranial pressure as well. But they were able to sort him out. So now these are your facial sinuses. So it's important to know that most of these are relatively interconnected. You know? So if you look at your maxillary sinus and your ethmoid sinus, I mean, these are quite well connected. Your sphenoid sinuses are connected again to your nasal cavity. Your frontal sinus also, although not quite obvious, is also connected through to the rest of the chair. So it's important to understand that these are all interconnected, and fractures of one may often lead to problems in the others and may lead to issues in terms of you know, sinus function and things like that. And very often these fractures do require a maxillofacial surgeon to have a look. Now, this was specific about the facial fractures, because in his case, he had a fracture going down that left maxillary sinus, and it was causing leakage, and there was a bit of sorry, I just looked out of my head. Muscular entrapment and things like that to the floor of the orbit. So there was quite a bit that was going on that they needed to sort out. And the thing is that anytime your sinuses are breached, they're prone to infection. Fractures involving the sinuses are very prone to infection. So, you know, there was quite a bit that was going on with this patient that could definitely have been improved. So what are the learning points that we have from this case? So in his case now, the bubbling and watery epistaxis, they should have pointed to, well, sinus injury, yes, or cranial injury with CSF leak, you know. So it could have just been an isolated sinus injury with with sinus fluid leaking out, but it could also have been a CSF leak as well. So as I mentioned to you guys before, if you're not sure if it's CSF, take a glucometer strip, put a bit of the clear fluid on it. Now, in this case, it would have been a bit difficult because it was a bit mixed with a bit of blood. But generally, CSF will register a value on a glucometer, whereas sinus fluid or any sort of inflammatory fluid doesn't register a glucose value. Right. So anytime you have a fracture of the anterior table of the frontal sinus, it's always good to do a CT because you check for fractures of the posterior table. Now, what I would say is that if you're not sure, ask a senior, because if it's just a straightforward linear fracture, there's no depression, there's nothing like that, it's not really necessary to do a CT unless there's other neurological signs, which in this case, I'm sure there would have been evidence of depression even on the X-ray, and it would have been important to do the CT scan. And the other thing that was important is that this patient had an open fracture. If you really look at it, I mean, this was a communicating open fracture. This was a fracture of the skull. The skin above it was open. There was communication between the sinus and the exterior, between the bone and the exterior. So it was an open fracture. And open fractures often need debridement, thorough washing. You can't just suture and discharge an antibiotics. If it's a non-communicating fracture, and if a specialist or a specialist department says sure, then it's a different story. Ideally, working in the emergency department, that isn't a decision you should take on your own. It's something that you should ask for, you know, an opinion, not because we don't know what's going on, but because there are medical legal implications if things go wrong. And it is a habit of most departments to try and pass blame. Unfortunately, it's a common thing now in medicine that, it's not me, it's you. You're the one who caused the problem. It was me. You never asked me. If you had asked me, I would have told you, and things like that. So it's always better to, just discuss any sort of open fracture with the relevant department. So in this case, it would have been surgical and maxillofacial and things like that. And I doubt very much they would have let this patient go. And even if there was no pneumocephalus, nothing else, but just based on what I could see, most likely they would have taken this patient in for debridement, repair, and switching. Okay. So, like I said, this patient was transferred to Nkosi Albert. He recovered, and it was just the management. I wouldn't say it was bad. It was just below par. We could have done better. That's about it. And when I say we, I don't mean you. I mean all of us. I'm not, these, it's not important to know who saw the patient, who did what wrong. It's important to know that these are mistakes that all of us make. Everybody, no matter your level, no matter your seniority, all of us have made mistakes. It's busy, we're tired, you've got your own problems going on. There's things that distract you at work. So when that's happening, when you're having a bad day or if you're not okay, it's important to just go back to your first principles of management and know just your basics. Even if you're not going to manage every MI 100% well, or you're not going to have, at least do the basics well and you'll see your own go wrong, And if you need to ask for help sooner rather than later, maybe you're not feeling yourself that day, whatever it may be. It's fine. Nobody will take it out on you. Just know it's not something you're doing all the time. So, in this case, I've given you guys all access to our protocols. And I mean, not just those who are working, but again, all of you who can go onto our website and see, we've got all of those protocols over there. I am busy drawing up some new ones as well, some updated ones. So, hopefully, that should be ready in a few months' time. We've got all our indications for CT and head trauma management and everything there. So it's important to use these things, And it's not to say you need to spend your weekends again reading protocols, but just skim through it. You've got access to it. You can just quickly go through it while you're on the floor and just have a look and say, okay, what should I do? Ideally, facial fractures should be discussed in our case with the surgery department, talking specifically about our hospital. But I mean, depending on where you work, you may have access to maxillofacials, trauma departments. It just depends where you are. It's important to make sure that they are discussed because some of these fractures can be quite extensive, can have severe morbidity and complications associated with them as well. And as I was saying, open fractures must be discussed with the relevant department. And if they do decide that it must be sutured and discharged, whatever it may be, it needs to have a good thorough washout. So, generally about 1 liter to 1.5 liters of fluid. You've just got to keep on washing out, washing out, washing out. Keep the patient on antibiotics, call them back for the follow-up. And ideally, it shouldn't be you as the emergency physician, the emergency department doctor who's making that decision. This should be told to, it should be said, okay, listen, we're not going to do anything more for this. You can wash it out, you can switch it and send the patient home. No problem, that's fine. But at least you've got something to say, well, listen, it wasn't my decision. Now, in this case, a washout would have not been the best thing, a severe or at least a very heavy washout. Even though a washout was documented, I don't think too much of water was used because in this case, it would have resulted in water infiltrating the cranial wall. So in this case, it was lucky. Maybe the washout was just a bit superficial, just a top wash, if I can put it that way, and just a wash and go like you get at the car washes. So it was quite lucky in this case because that can often lead to quick spread of infection and things like that. So this is why in this case, it would have been very important to discuss with somebody more senior and decide what to do. These are difficult cases because they're not seen that often. But if you remember your basics of management of head trauma, you shouldn't reach these stages. And not only that, if you remember the basics and the norm and the common presentation, whenever anything seems abnormal, that's when you should ask for help, even if you don't know what. So, for example, this bubbling at the wound, the watery epistaxis, things like that. These are things that are not seen every day. You might see them once a year or once every 2 years, and it's the type of thing that you should then ask for help and say, okay, listen, I'm not sure what's going on here. I know something's going on. Right? There's bubbling, so there's air. Where is this air coming from? Even if you don't know, if you can't make it out in that minute, nobody's going to chastise you for asking. You know, I mean, you will get those people who walk into your department and go, this is obviously coming from the science. How stupid are you? You get those people. And what you do is you just let it roll off your back because they've only got to concentrate on their area. When you work in an emergency department, you're seeing everything from every specialty. This doesn't mean you don't know what's going on. It just means you cannot focus on the intricacies of each particular specialty. You have to be able to know the normals and the normal presentations and the normal abnormal presentations, like put it that way. And this is when you ask for help outside of those standard, let's say outside the standard deviations, let's put it that way, so that you get an idea of what is going on and how to ask for help. So you always got those people who are insulting and who are not there to really help you, but are just irritated that they're being called. It's part of working in an emergency department. You've just got to let it roll off your back, but you still got to ask for help because it's the patient who suffers at the end of the day if we don't help them. So this is just some interesting stuff now. So this is a craniotomy for hematoma removal. So this is a lovely thing. I found it online. And for those of you who've been following the Twitter account as well, I had one or two of these actually put up short videos that I retweeted from Dr. Gottfried. Who I'm really enjoying following as well, Dr. Owen Gottfried. He's got all of these amazing neurosurgical cases. And if you have a chance, please go through and have a look. So, you know, they're just talking about how the bicoronal incision is made, the bifrontal bone flap is removed, and how the brain is retracted, revealing the hematoma, and how the hematoma is removed with suction. And they had one the other day. I just don't have it at the moment. I'm going to see if I can find it on here. Maybe I'll just quickly look for it and put it on the video as well. But just how this thing just slid off one of the brains. So I'll try and get that maybe just at the end of this presentation, just put it on there. And then here they're just talking about the fracture of the ethmoid sinuses and, you know, just how you basically get the, you know, as they say, we're using a high-speed drill. The optic nerve is decompressed bilaterally and reconstruction of the supraorbital form. So I think here they were just talking about something a bit different. Yeah. So this is quite amazing how they do it. And I must be honest, having only had a chance to see one or two neurosurgical procedures, I actually regret not seeing more. It looks absolutely interesting having now looked at it a bit more. And this is just something in terms of terminology. So for those of you who are going to be working in more intelligent areas than under me, you know, at least you won't get caught out. So I didn't know there was a difference between a craniotomy and a craniectomy. So basically a craniotomy and a craniectomy is, as it says here, usually the first part of further brain surgery, the bone flap is temporarily removed and then returned to the skull after surgery. So basically remove the bone, put it back. Whereas a craniectomy is often formed to relieve pressure. The bone flap is surgically removed and it's not immediately put back. So these are the patients, I guess, that you'll often see with helmets and protective gear. And I have seen one or two of them that are quite amazing as well online. So, you know, just something for you to know the difference between those two. Okay, so this was the one that I actually wanted to show you guys. So it's just a subdural hematoma. And here we can see after. You know, as he says, it's just a subdural hematoma just sliding off the brain. It doesn't usually happen this well. So that was quite an interesting one. And I said Owen Gottfried. So quite an interesting one just to see how that hematoma comes off. So yeah, that was just the one that I wanted to show you, right? So just something interesting to learn and something interesting to see. I'm sure there's much longer videos on it, but I don't have any at the moment. And anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed that. And hopefully next week we'll try and cover scorpion stings and spider bites. And until then, keep bye.